Hello, baby.
Hello, nasty.
Hello.
That's right, episode 73 of The Brink of Sanity. I am Jay, and with me today is Leon.
Hey, 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 what's going on, people?
How's it going, everyone? It has been a little while.
Yeah, dude, it's been a while.
It's been a while since we did a coherent show. You were on a few episodes ago, but not one of my prouder moments.
Wow, I don't think I remember it.
I sound like Barney from The Simpsons. We're really struggling just to form coherent sentences.
Dude, are you kidding? That was the best rated show ever.
Might have been. Who knows?
Dude, that was a lot of shots that night.
There was a lot of drinking going on that night.
We were just not drinking.
Yeah, we went to this place, Barcade, that has old school 80s arcade games and like 50 yeah. kinds of beer. Then we went to some random music show. Yeah. And then...
In between, we just had a lot of shots.
Well, the whole time we're talking about how we're going to do an awesome drunken podcast. Mm. But then we got too awesome and drunk.
Yeah,
and
we can never be too awesome, or we can never not be awesome and drunk.
Right?
Does that make sense?
Yeah, I think so.
You know what I meant.
I know.
Hey, man! Congratulations on your 73rd show.
Thank you.
Getting up there.
Getting up there.
Getting up there, man.
27 more episodes till I quit,
or until you throw the best 100th show ever,
or that.
You know,
one or the other. I'm torn.
One or the other, man. But anyways, good to be here. Back in the Brink of Sanity.
Yeah, good to have you. I'm glad I'm actually going to remember this episode, and we might actually get to some actual topics instead of a slur, slur, slur.
Yeah, I mean, we're still having our drinks now. We're just being a little bit more moderate with our drinking, if you will.
Yeah, a little moderate.
A little moderate.
It's Wednesday. I mean, I don't like getting too retarded, on a work night. But speaking of that, I am thinking of doing a Power Hour episode on a Friday coming up soon.
Ooh.
I think that's a brilliant idea.
So when you have one of these shows with the Power Hour shows, do you have you usually have a multitude of guests? Or is it just – does it matter?
If I do a Power Hour show?
Yeah.
I've never done a Power Hour show. I would think I would have a few people because people are going to be having to go to the bathroom or just – dying. I'll probably have like 3 or 4 people here.
Okay, so
we could have a guy who pours shots.
It's been a while since I was in college or did any of that. What exactly power hours when you have a drink or a shot every minute?
Yeah, one shot of beer every minute for an hour.
God.
And the shot of beer is like, you think it's a joke for the first like 10 minutes.
You're like, then, bring it.
Yeah, but 5 minutes later, when you hit like the 15th minute, you're just like, oh, it's starting to kick in already. By like minute 20, you're just like, oh, I'm going to die tonight.
Dude, I am a big beer drinker. I say you sign me up for this.
All right. You're in.
That'll be a brilliant episode.
So we got you. Mark is signed up for this, and I believe the doc will be in for that too. So
nice,
I think that's a good lineup for that.
That's definitely a good crew.
Yeah. So I was thinking the weekend of like the 28th of August.
August.
Coming up
August,
soon.
August. Oh.
Of course you have a problem
balls.
With that, right?
Yeah. I'll be in Hawaii.
Well, I don't feel bad for
that's
you.
It's a tough life I lead, isn't it, Jay?
It is. It is really rough. Well, I don't know. Maybe we'll... plan a different week, or maybe we'll just do a second one. I say that now before I do the first one.
You know what, though? The week after the 28th?
Can't do it.
Oh, it'll be Labor Day weekend.
Yeah.
Are you skipping town? Anyways, yeah. We'll talk logistics at some other time. If you can do it without me, go ahead and do it, but I would definitely like to take part in it.
You guys don't want to hear event planning cast? Anybody? No?
I'm going to go ahead and say they probably don't. So what's on the agenda today?
Well,
what are we talking about?
We got a lot of stuff today. If anybody wants to give us a call, it's 631-676-1181. As usual, it's the live call-in number, and it's also the voicemail number for when we're not on.
Ow!
Yeah.
Oh, and Twitter. Don't forget they can catch us on Twitter.
Twitter.com/Brink of Sanity.
That's right. And don't be like me. I was listening to a show one time, and I was tutoring myself silly, only to have people behind the mic ignore me the entire time.
I did not know there was an option to see live Twitters, and now I do. Ustream has got a lot of upgrades over Stick'Em. I did not know that.
Ustream's cool, man.
See live Twitters, yeah.
Yeah, it's actually a pretty cool function and very popular nowadays. So hopefully it doesn't turn to shit.
It is. It's, I don't know. It's almost a little too popular. I really, it's like a story when like somebody famous Twitters, and I really just don't give a shit, you know.
Actually, some of the people that are actually on Twitter who will go ahead and do these streams are completely fucking terrible.
Tweet.
Whoa. Oh, nice. What is this? Hipster douchebag.
Hipster douchebag soundboard.
Obs.
Jeez.
Yeah, but anyway, some of the people that do it are just absolutely crap. They just sit there and they just do absolutely nothing. And, you know, you see this whole stream of questions coming in, which could make for entering interesting interaction between the quote-unquote celebrity and the regular Joe Schmoes.
Mm-hmm.
And they don't even look at them. They just proceed with eating their sandwich, you know, one of them being Chris Bosh. Obviously, you're familiar with Chris Bosh.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, he's doing his whole little Twitter army bull crap. I actually ended up running into him at Steve Nash's soccer tournament.
Really?
And he was playing, you know, he's like a tall, lanky, skinny fucking black dude on the field. They were like, who is this guy? Ends up being Bosh or whatever. So I'm like, fucking, you know, he could be kind of interested to follow on Twitter. And, you know, he's got his funny little things, but if you don't even bother ever watching one of his YouTube streams unless you want to fall asleep or want something to make you fall asleep. Sorry, I'm just putting it out there.
All right. Well, this has been a week of many crazy run-ins with crazy people.
Mm.
So the first one was, Friday at your girlfriend's birthday, and you missed it.
All right, so Friday was a pretty cool night. It was actually the celebration for my girlfriend's 25th birthday.
Mm-hmm.
And so we ended up going to a place down by the South Street Seaport here in Manhattan called Jeremy's Ale House. And so we had a good crew. We were hanging out outside. They actually serve you beer. I wish we actually had a picture to show a post. They actually serve you beers in these gigantic styrofoam cups. And when I say gigantic, they're huge. And they're like $6.50. So, you know, a couple of those and you got a foot in the gutter. And fantastic. And so apparently Jay and Cad decided to make a cameo towards the end of the night. And I missed the interesting fight that you were going to be talking about. I guess telling me about, because I don't even know the story.
It wasn't even toward the end of the night. I mean, we got lost, but we were there by like 9. And okay. I think by like 9:30, this guy in his awesome motorcycle was getting into an argument with some girl.
Wait, I love when you start a story with a guy in his awesome motorcycle.
His hog.
The sarcasm is brilliant.
He brought his hog on his hog.
His rice burner.
And they got into an argument, and he ended up pushing her like pretty hard. And that didn't go over so well. She started screaming and yelling, and I think she punched or kicked his awesome motorcycle. And then some other guy stepped in and they started getting into an argument. And eventually everyone started walking away. But then I guess the guy with the motorcycle thought better of it and decided to throw a temper tantrum. And so when everyone else was like 20, 30 feet away, he threw his helmet against the window of the next apartment building, which was also about 3 feet away from a restaurant where people were eating.
Mm.
And then he punched a car really hard. And then I guess he was going to get his helmet when the couple that was eating, the guy said, you know, something like, don't throw a helmet like 2 feet from where we're eating.
Wait a second. So he was on our side of the street and he ended up
side of the street.
And then he threw it towards our direction?
No, he threw it like behind, like, you know, at the building that was like 2 feet away.
And so the guy that was sitting over there eating a lovely dinner with his girlfriend, friend, whatever, got up and actually got in his face.
He just said something from the table, you know, like, hey, calm down or, you know. And so the guy with the helmet picked up his helmet, slammed it on their dinner table and like leaned over and started screaming in the guy's face who was eating.
What the fuck? How did I miss this?
It was going on and on. I mean, this is like, you know, this is like 3-4 minutes into his temper tantrum at this point. And then the restaurant people came over and tried to push him to the side. And then he finally got on his awesome motorcycle and drove away really fast. I was really waiting for him to crash, like, right at the end of the block.
Nice.
Because it was a bus pulling up. And I'm like, please have that bus just run over him when he gets to the corner.
So did anybody, when he initially pushed the girl,
mm-hmm.
he pushed her hard?
Yeah, pretty hard.
And nobody around there decided to intervene and say, hey, dude, that's not cool.
One guy ran up to him. I think he was actually ended up in the bar that we were at. Hmm. I think I saw him telling the story at a table later. he went up to the guy.
War story.
The guy got in his face, and I thought they were going to throw down for a little bit. But I think it was one of those guys that likes to yell and intimidate and then not do anything about it.
Fucking meathead.
Yeah, you ever see those, you know, those jock fights in a bar where they're like, step up, bro. Why don't you hit me?
Why don't you step up?
Yeah, why don't you hit me first? What, are you going to front? They just do that for like an hour, and then they both suck step each other's up. Cocks and go to bed.
With their collars popped.
Exactly.
Oh, man, yeah, I'm totally sad I missed that story. I think I was drunk pretty much the entire time I was there, so I recall some drama happening, but it was like the last tail end, and mm-hmm. I totally missed all the fun stuff.
You should tweet that.
Nice. Well, thank you, I will.
Good input. Thank you, Hipster Douchebag. He'll be with us all night.
Oh, God. He's great, actually.
Yeah. He's pretty good.
He's pretty fantastic, man. So,
what are you wearing tonight?
Skinny jeans.
Awesome.
Of course he would be. Where does he live? Is there a Williamsburg? Oh, sorry.
No, it's not that specific.
No? All right.
Jay's apartment.
Nice.
Fact of Life t-shirt. Nice.
Oh, the ironic tee.
Mm-hmm.
Gotta love the ironic tees.
Ironic tee.
All right, man. So what else is happening?
I ran into another crazy person the day before your party.
Hmm.
This guy was one of the scariest looking people I've seen. He looked like he was from that band Slipknot.
Mm-hmm.
Just really long, dirty, curly hair. Eyes with just nothing in them. Like, I don't know what he was on. I don't know if he was just blacked out drunk or he was on some hardcore drugs, but he just looked fucked. And he was, like, stumbling down the street, and then he sees this guy on a bike and decides to just attack him. And this is, like, literally, like, 4 feet from where we're standing.
This in the city?
Yeah. This is on, like, 2nd Ave and, like, 9th Street or something. And he like, his head snaps up when he sees the bike, and he just runs over and just pushes the guy off the bike. And the guy is just like, what the fuck? And the guy can't form a sentence or say anything, so he just, like, stares at him. He's, like, you know, breathing deeply, and he's, like, you know, looking at the tops of his eyes. Yeah. And so the guy tries to get back on the bike, and the guy's, like, stumbling. Like, he's so fucked up, he can't really go fast, but he's, like, kind of, like, stumbling toward him with one hand out, like a linebacker.
Yeah, yeah.
Whatever position in football that is with your hand stuck out. Mm-hmm. And he goes toward him, he pushes the guy again. He's like, why are you bothering me? Stop it.
Really? So the guy was a real pussy?
The guy was, like, totally fruity. It was hilarious. He's why are you doing this to me? So the guy,
because you're on a Vespa.
he just goes across the street and then stops again to wait for the light. If a crazy man is attacking you, you bike away. Like, you go down the block. He he thought, like, going across the street, like, 4 feet away would stop him. So the guy just stumbles across the street, knocks him off the bike again.
Again?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Is anybody doing anything at all, or are they just kind of crowding around and saying, this is fucking hilarious?
Yeah, everyone just looking at it because he's not fucking the guy up to the point where it's, like, dangerous. He's kind of just, like, tipping him over, because this is, like, a really fucked up guy with no strength, and then a really wussy guy who can't keep his balance from the light tap. So it's not, you know, it's violent, but not to the point where everyone's like, oh, we should probably stop this. It's,
right,
just like,
funny,
let's see where
comical.
This goes. Yeah, you got some popcorn? Let's see what happens. Yeah. So then he crosses the street the far way, you know, because it was like a, you know, it's a wide road one way and a skinny road the other way. So he crosses the avenue, which is the wide road. And the guy is starting to follow him, and a cop has ended up coming up across coming up the street. So the guy waves the cop over, and somehow his primal instincts kicked in, and the fucked up guy, like, turned in the other direction, just started walking away like nothing happened.
Mm-hmm.
And so the other guy's, like, trying to tell the cops, like, that guy right there is attacking me. Go get him. You know, he's knocking me off my bike. The cop, it was just one of those guys that just wants absolutely nothing to do with helping or doing anything, I guess. Because he's, like, slowly getting out of his car and, like, well, what seems to be the problem? And just stalling until the guy's gone. And then he's like, well, he's gone.
Sorry.
I can't do anything about it, man.
Yeah.
You know,
sorry.
He disappeared into the crowd. Don't you think, like, if somebody says, hey, he's attacking me, you'd stop them both and then, like, find out what happened? Yeah. The guy was literally, like, 4 feet from the cop car, and he was pointing at him, saying, that's the guy. And, yeah, the dickhead cop was just, like, stalling.
Well, was he a dickhead cop or was he a pussy cop?
Both. I mean,
oh, you're probably scared of it and intimidated of the other guy. I was like, you know what, I'm going to pretend that I'm going to, you know, whatever, and just let him go on purpose.
If you're going to be that big of a
wuss,
of a pussy, don't be a cop. Don't be a cop. Don't be a security guard. Don't be an agent. You know, I don't get why you choose that profession if you don't want to. Like, the guy was a fucked up maniac, but he wasn't, like, scary, you know? Mm. I mean, he was, like, scary looking, but he wasn't going to hurt you. That's what I'm trying to say. Right, like, right. He was too fucked up to, like, do any damage.
You know, had he approached you, would you have been the same? Would you have had the same reaction as the guy on the bike, or would you have actually been like, dude, you're being inappropriate, go fuck yourself, and push him back?
Well, there was no point in using more than 2-syllable words with him, you know?
You back.
You stop.
Now.
Or me smash. You know, that's pretty much.
Bottle. Head.
See, the thing is, like, he was so fucked up, you probably could have destroyed him, but he was also so fucked up, he might not have been able to feel pain, and that's where it gets scary.
Right.
You know, then it's like a zombie movie. You just got to behead him to get rid of him. So, I mean, if I was on my bike, I might have just biked away because, you know, then the problem's over, like, right away. But, you know, if he turned to me, because he was, like, literally standing in front of me pushing the guy. So if he turned around and pushed me, yeah, I would have pushed him back because, you know, when the girl's there, you got to, you know. Plus, like, that was a fight. Like, I'm pretty sure I could have won. He was pretty messed up.
Yeah.
He was moving in slow motion. Like, I don't know how the guy didn't get away anyway.
That's fucking hilarious. Yeah. I wish I would have seen that. Yeah. I would have just been, like you said earlier, you know, who's got the popcorn? Let's do this.
Exactly. So that's like two funny kind of fight stories. Like,
I saw
within a 2-day span. Not bad.
Yeah, not bad at all. I kind of like that. I mean, I saw a quasi fight story. I went to the AC/DC concert a couple of weeks ago at Giant Stadium. It was fucking, you know, it's an awesome fucking show. I was setting up on the nosebleeds. I could barely even see Angus. But you know, at those shows, you know, you find a lot of meatheads, you find a lot of old like old people and people with attitudes and yada yada yada. And then we're walking outside or whatever, and this guy, you know, ends up accidentally bumping into another guy who the other guy happens to be fucking huge. And the other guy doesn't really apologize. He just kind of, you know, say whatever. And so the other guy gets all offended. He's like, are you going to say I'm sorry? And the guy's like, are you fucking kidding me, dude? Look at the fucking crowd all around us. Hey, but we're all pushing into each other. No. A little while, they started verbally fucking talking smack to each other. And this one guy could have totally destroyed guy B.
Mm-hmm.
Guy B, though, I'll give it up to him, had fucking balls of steel. You know, he kept talking shit back, and he kept staring at him hardcore afterwards. Even I was like, dude, you may want to tone it down a bit. This guy can totally walk all over you.
Right, right.
And and the guy who, guy A, you know, for some reason, just, you know, was very intimidating towards him. But at the end of the day, didn't really do nothing. He was one of those guys, you know, whose bark is louder than
I find that's like, most people.
Yeah,
really, a lot of them just like to get in people's faces and
pretend to be fucking cool and tough.
Yeah,
which but at the end of the day, the smaller guy was, in my opinion, the tougher one because he kept talking back, and then when there was no verbal communication, it was all in the eye, and the guy just kept looking at him, staring at him, like, "What are you gonna do? You're talking all this shit to me? Fuck you!"
Uh-huh.
Without having to say a word.
Right, right.
You know, and I was like, "Good for you, buddy. You're gonna get your ass kicked, but good for you."
Yeah.
But that was just a typical night at AC/DC.
There's a lot of people that just go out and say, I want to get into a fight tonight. I never understood that.
Yeah.
When I was in high school, this guy is like, he was, you know, he kind of knew me and my other buddy. And he would like, he'd see us like, you know, in the neighborhood. He'd be like, hey, you want to go get into a fight tonight? And we're just like, no, not really, yeah, actually. Yeah. You know.
Yeah, it's true. People like that in my high school as well, you know. I was, you know, we'd be out drinking, and there'd be somebody who didn't drink a beer that they liked or something, and they would just, you know, for the hell of it, just kick his ass.
Mm-hmm.
I don't understand that kind of mentality, that pit bull mentality.
It's
but, like I'm by no means a tree hugger or a fucking pacifist, but I'm also not a fucking animal.
Right. I just don't see the point. It's, you know, you can try and have a good time, or you can have drama every time you go out. I just don't get it.
Yeah. I don't know. Whatever.
Yeah.
Let's chuck it up as a meathead.
Totes.
Thank you.
There he is again. Uh-huh. Wait, what's his name? What did we name this guy?
Hipster Douchebag.
The Hipster Douchebag.
Yeah.
The HD.
What's your favorite sport?
Kickball.
Of course. Yep. Where do you get all your money?
Trust fund.
I'm not surprised. That's where you live, live in Williamsburg and overlook the park, huh?
That's how he rolls.
Yeah, you know.
Vintage.
Mm-hmm.
Vintage, yeah.
You don't even know.
What's one of your favorite bands, dude?
The Yeah Yeah Yeahs played in my living room in like 2001, so...
Oh, really?
Mm.
Oh, he's a cool guy now. He's name dropping.
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah, he goes shopping for all the good stuff.
Has anyone seen my John Varvatos iPod case?
John Varvatos? I actually went into that store.
I don't even know what that is.
Dude, okay, so John Varvatos is like, he's like a designer, you know, whatever. Like, you see the billboards all over the city, and he's got people like Iggy Pop, I think, is one of them. People like Joe Perry, who kind of like just putting clothes on. It's pretty much a fucking D-bag who charges like fucking $300 for a t-shirt. And so they actually made the old CBGB space.
Mm-hmm.
Into the new John Varvatos store.
Crying shame.
I swear to God, dude. And so we're walking down the Bowery, and we're like, you know what? I have to go in. This is very sacrilegious. Actually, the first time that I was at CBGB was I was with you. I don't know if you recall.
Yeah, absolutely. That was the first time I was at CBGB.
Yeah,
too.
So what a fucking shithole that was. But at the end of the day, it was an institution. You know what I mean?
You should have been there.
Totally should have been there. But, dude, and now it's totally like you walk in there and you buy a t-shirt. I swear to God, it's like $150. And jeans are like fucking like $200. And so they decided to save face by keeping this sort of wall of like all the original stickers that were on the wall. And I'm like, this place is a fucking joke.
That's ridiculous.
But I'm sure I got people like the Hipster Douchebag do frequent that place, don't they?
I tote spilled PBR all over my scarf.
Oh, my God. Your scarf from John Varvatos. Nice. Why don't you go ahead and what do they call that?
Tweet.
Of course. Why don't you go ahead and tweet that?
You should tweet that.
You do it.
You should tweet that.
Fuck you. You do it.
You should tweet that.
All right. Fine. Not arguing with this guy.
Yeah, man.
Soundboards.
What are you talking about, dude? He's sitting in the next room.
It's going to be our new guest. What do you guys think of a permanent co-host, Hipster Douchebag? I won't even have to look for co-host anymore.
There you go.
Every single show, you can just hear.
I despise Starbucks.
I'm like, yeah, man. Starbucks, rock on. Starbucks sucks.
Yeah, right.
What'd you do today?
I might start a Facebook group for my loft.
Mm-hmm.
For your loft? Yeah. Listen, man, so what do you do for a living? Do you do any social networking on sites or professional sites or anything?
I'm a freelance blogger / DJ / film producer.
Oh, yeah?
Of course.
Yeah. How do you network? Are you on LinkedIn or anything?
Fun employment.
Fun employment.
Yeah, I bet it is.
Nice. Well, accept me on LinkedIn. Let's be friends. Let's hook up.
I'll accept him on LinkedIn. But not Facebook.
Of course not. You're not at that point in your relationship yet.
Can you Facebook a LinkedIn?
I don't even know what that is.
I'm always trying to combination you.
Can you Facebook a LinkedIn? I'm not savvy enough to do that. Hipster, sorry. Obs? Are you obsing me?
Obs.
Totes. Totes, dude. Totally totes. So have you been to any of the quote-unquote pool parties happening at the Williamsburg waterfront where you actually do find these people?
No. Is that where the big pool parties used to be?
Well, that's like where they used to have the pool parties. They're actually making that into a pool again.
Yeah, I know. That's bullshit.
Yeah, making it into a pool. Well, I mean, you know, whatever for the kids.
For those of you who don't know, it's in Brooklyn. It's this huge it used to be a public pool. It's massive. It's like, I don't even know. Was it like a mile wide or something? It's ridiculous.
Yeah, it was huge. It was like a mile long.
It was like that in the 70s.
A square foot, whatever.
But they emptied it out, and
and it was empty for a long time.
Yeah.
So what they ended up doing is, you know, this company called Jolly NYC ended up saying, you know what, we got a great space here, Williamsburg, the epicenter of the fucking hipster scumbag world. Let's go ahead and have some parties here. Which you know to their
totes.
Yeah, exactly, dude. They actually have had, and they're the fans have had a couple of good bands play there. I saw bands like Ghostland and
Vintage.
Vintage.
They're not vintage.
So the parties have actually now been moved to the waterfront in Williamsburg, which is over like over on Cantwell, killer view of the city. But it's hipster douchebag fucking central down there with their
locavore.
What?
I don't even know what that is.
You know, with their ironic tees and with their cool tattoos and with the cool jean shirts, the cool jean shorts,
skinny jeans.
They don't wear skinny jeans. Oh, but you know what I do hate is the hipster dudes who wear those flimsy Keds girl sneakers.
Mm-hmm.
Have you noticed those?
I saw one for the first time today, actually.
Oh, my God. Yeah. For the first time?
Yeah.
Fucking D-bags. Those were made for women in the 80s. Do not wear them.
Mm-hmm.
But anyways, yeah, if you want to go see some of those hipster douchebags, go to the waterfront. But they also, in their defense, like I said, they do have sometimes, occasionally... pretty rockin'.
Did I tell you as recently as like 4 years ago, I didn't know what a hipster was?
Really?
Yeah.
And you live in New York City?
Yeah.
They're all over the place.
I know. Well, here's the thing. My friend threw a hipster party.
I'm sorry. Then I have a lot of those are full hipsters. Anyways.
Okay. My friend threw a hipster party and I didn't know what a hipster was. So I'm like, you know, all right, what's a hipster? He goes, look up a picture of the Strokes. So I look up a picture of the Strokes, but I guess I looked up one of their weird fashion shoot things, and they were dressed up kind of like Eurotrash. So I wore like, you know, like raver clothes.
And oh, good Lord.
And I go in, and everyone's dressed like I normally dress. I was like, fuck. I could have just worn my normal outfit.
Well, you do have a lot of what they call now ironic tees. But yeah. It's by ironic tee, just like, you know, something that... It was popular at some point, like the teenage
like my Ninja Turtles
shirt, or like your Family Guy shirt, except with the exception that yours aren't tight fitting.
Well, thank God they aren't.
Yeah, you're not a douchebag.
Plus, I also made them so they're of weird characters, like the old man pedophile guy, or
oh, that's awesome.
I had one of the monkey after the first season when he was only in like one episode,
in the closet.
Before they like overused them.
Yes.
So yes. You know it's. I made it a little different. It's not like I just, oh, Stewie, I hate everything shirt.
Yeah. Or I'm going to kill you, blah, blah, blah.
Well, now he's gay, so.
Stewie's gay?
Yeah.
Is that show still on TV?
It's so bad now, yeah. That show got, it had like the half-life of The Simpsons. Like, The Simpsons was good for 10 years, and now is the worst show. Family Guy was like less than half of that.
Now, who was one of your favorite, I'm actually going somewhere with this. Who was one of your favorite characters on the show besides any of the immediate family people? Who would you actually go ahead?
I was a big Quagmire fan. I liked
Yikity Yikity.
My favorite was Adam West.
Adam West.
I made an Adam West shirt actually too.
Oh, nice. Yeah. The reason I bring that up is because they're going to actually, I don't know if you heard about this yet, but there's actually going to be a spinoff of the show.
Yes, I heard about that, which is going to be awful.
Cleveland Brown.
Yeah. That's going to be so bad. He's funny for like a line or two an episode.
Exactly.
For a whole half hour, not fun.
I have no idea where they're going to go with that, dude. I honestly have no idea where they're going to go with that.
I don't know. And then he's got American Dad, so it's just going to be a whole night of Seth MacFarlane.
American Dad is pretty bad, too. American Dad is basically a replica, a mirror image of that show with Bobcat Goldthwait. Remember Bobcat Goldthwait used to – that in itself was a spinoff – not a spinoff, a mirror image of Married with Children.
Oh, yes. I know exactly what you're talking about. It was the guy who talked to the puppet.
Yes.
But every other character was exactly the same. He looked and talked like Al Bundy.
Yeah,
even though he made a career out of himself,
he did.
He was on 24. He was the president for a season. He was right now. He's on.
Seen him somewhere.
Right now he's on Dexter. He's the head of the police.
Oh, he's a police. Yes, dude, you're totally right.
Unhappily Ever After.
Unhappily Ever After. What a fucking joke that
was. Do you know
was.
That in the first season they didn't have the hot girl with the big breasts and the ratings weren't that good, so they added her in the second season and just said, "Oh, that's my daughter." And the ratings like shot up and ended up being on for like six seasons.
Well, that's funny. The same thing happened with the Black Eyed Peas.
Their first album didn't have Fergie?
No, not at all.
Oh, wow.
And I know that because I used to work the record industry. When they got it, we're like, okay, well, like, we're going to sell some records now. And of course, they started sucking in. But anyway, so...
Their new song is the worst song I've ever heard in my entire life.
Which one is that?
Ding-a-ling-a-ling.
Ding-a-ling-a-ling. I thought that Boom 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 song was bad
enough. No, much worse.
Can it get much worse than give me that Boom Boom Boom?
I will listen to Boom 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 for 7 hours straight before I hear that other song once.
Really? Can we hear a bit of it?
Yeah, I'm gonna pull up a clip of that because it's something you just have to hear for yourself. And you're never gonna want to hear it ever again.
Nigga, that boom boom pow.
It's it is on a whole new level of piece of shit. Let's see if this is on here. I'm glad somebody posted the lyrics because there's one line the whole time. This is it. Wait. This is the whole song. Over and over and over.
This is not the whole song, dude. 4.5 minutes?
The whole song.
Let's skip up to like minute
two. I'll skip 2 minutes in. It's going to be the exact same part. When first, he's got to speak through his voice synthesizer. Oh my god, alright, it's worse than I thought. Well, auto tune.
God, could they not be the worst fucking group ever?
That's 3 minutes in. Go 4 minutes in. It's probably the same shit.
Wow.
Pretty much, yeah.
They definitely got the nomination for one of the best, the worst, I mean, groups ever.
Yeah, that is a whole new level of bullshit. And all the comments on YouTube are just awesome. This song is hot. That rules.
Terrible.
Why would you like that at all?
Probably all the fucking tweens.
It doesn't matter. Like when I was a tween, I listened to like Pink Floyd and Led Zeppelin. Like you don't have to listen to shit.
Well, your dad also owned a record store.
Yeah,
there's a difference.
All right, but before he
when I was a tween, I was listening to Vanilla Ice, so I really, you know, I was just as bad.
Well, even Vanilla Ice is better than that.
Oh, what, are you kidding me? 10 times better.
Marky Mark and the Funky Bunch.
Marky Mark and the Funky Bunch.
You know, kids now don't even know that he was Marky Mark.
Really?
He's just Mark Wahlberg. He's one of the only people that was able to totally erase his image and start over again.
Although I used to hear that if you actually approach him and say, "Hey, Marky Mark and the Funky Bunch," he'll actually like. I think he actually punched the dude in the face once.
Yeah, he doesn't like it
because he's an idiot. Well, dude, it's part of your past. Get over it. Fucking live with it.
Right. Well, it's like Vanilla Ice. He doesn't want to be known for Ice Ice Baby, but then he started a heavy metal band and he remixed the song. It's like, if you want people to forget about it, don't make a new version of it.
What a douchebag! MC Hammer actually has his own show now. It's on.
VH1.
It's EVH1. It's I don't know. He has,
who doesn't have their own show now?
So he actually ended up doing a show with Vanilla Ice at the University of Utah or Brigham Young or some bullshit like that. And, you know, like their whole thing was, you know, it was going to be a reunion. It was going to be this big fucking show. It was going to be fucking rad. And, like, if you look at the audience, these kids are all, you know, like in their late teens, early 20s, a.k.a. college kids, people who weren't around to experience, you know, Ice Ice Baby or You Can't Touch This.
Why would they even be there? So, do they only know him from reality
shows? No, but that's the thing, because it's a complete mockery. You know, these kids are there making fun of you and dressing like you, thinking it's fucking funny and thinking it's fucking hilarious because you're a fucking tool. MC Hammer is doing a prayer beforehand because he's taking the show so serious. All these kids are there just making fun of him and thinking it's fucking hilarious that a fucking washed up rapper from the 80s is making a comeback.
Is he wearing his Hammer pants?
He's kind of thuggish now. You know, with the bandana around his bald head.
No, that doesn't work.
That's what I got, dude. And I'm like Hammer. You know,
don't hurt him. Please. Zing! Worst joke of the entire series of the show.
That was great, but yeah. So I kind of felt bad for the guy.
For those of you born after like 1985, his second album was "Please Hammer, Don't Hurt Him."
That was a pretty cool album, actually.
I may have listened to a couple.
Wait, is that
songs.
The one that has "Too Legit"?
Yeah,
too legit to quit. Hey.
Yep.
And then you do the whole thing with the hands. It's a peace sign with the L, a peace sign with the L, a peace sign, and then you slash your throat. So too legit to quit.
I didn't even know that.
Are you kidding me, dude? Come on.
No.
Yeah, peace sign, L, peace sign, L, peace sign, slash your throat.
Wow.
Dude, someone did it back then in the 80s. Well, early 90s.
You were pretty hardcore.
I'm also sweating my balls off in here, by the way.
I know. I ran the air conditioner for like 2 hours before you came over just to try and get the room cool because I didn't want to like a hum throughout the whole show. But that might be our new motif until like September or October rolls around, because this is pretty brutal.
So do we have anybody checking in via Twitter or any other site that wants to check in and say hello?
Doesn't look like it so far.
All right.
That number, again, is 631-676-1181. We will be here for another half hour, I believe.
Yeah, as long as I got some more vino.
Yeah. Going through that pretty quick.
It's good for the heart.
Yeah, we have white vino. Right. Blanco vino.
Well, should I text the ladies to bring it in?
Sure. Vino Blanco ASAPO.
Dude, so let me ask you a question.
Yeah.
Let's get serious for a second here.
Let's bring it down a notch.
I'm having a really difficult time at work.
Okay.
All right. So I'm having a very difficult time because of one particular person that I got to deal with. Now, this is the kind of person that, you know, we're completely lateral, sales, marketing. The accounts that I deal with are this person's accounts as well. He's basically making my job unbearable to the point where I'm like, I'd rather not be employed than have to deal with this fucking douchebag.
Who really?
He likes to just kind of go back and forth. He makes work counterproductive. You know, we've been trying to do this one project for the last 2 weeks and a half. The client is waiting. Argumentative emails back and forth that his whole thing is, you know, he goes about it, hey, thank you for the email, Leon, and the correspondence and blah, 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 blah. However, blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, however, this is exactly why this, I did this, blah, 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 blah. Mm-hmm. And it's basically counterproductive because we don't get anything done because we just keep going back and forth. You send me an email, I'll be like, you're a douchebag and here's why. And then he'll send me one back. And then he's one of those people who likes to copy his boss on every single email.
Oh, yeah.
Fucking nauseous. Does he wipe your ass too, dude? Honestly, does your boss need to be copied? Because my when I was a manager, overseeing a team, listen, dude, don't fucking CC me unless it's fucking needed. You know?
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, we can figure that shit out. So my question to you is, how do you deal with a difficult coworker? Have you ever had a difficult worker? And what's some advice so that I don't end up fucking slicing this kid's throat?
Well, I actually had a guy who was a CC monster. And
I like that. A CC monster.
He, I had like, what is it called? Not a recurring cell. It's one of those like formulas where it like, it references itself. Anyway, it was in one of the forms I was making up, one of the spreadsheets I was making up, and it didn't affect the actual, I work in tax. It didn't affect the actual tax number. Mm-hmm. It actually had no bearing on the project whatsoever, but the cell was wrong. So he emailed me, but he copied four different managers on that.
Oh.
And
now, had he come to you prior and just with a regular email, or is he
no.
a constant?
Nope.
Like,
nope.
He must have made himself.
The first I heard of it. Redundant cell, I think it was called. First I heard of it. CC'd four managers. And, it was literally like one press of a button. Like, you literally just like delete one of the cells it was adding up in the sum formula. And so I wrote back. CC'd all the managers, and I knew half of them weren't going to get it, but I knew like my direct manager has a sense of humor, so he was going to get it. So I wrote like, thank you so much for pointing this out. I'm really glad you brought this to my attention because,
nice.
This has been the biggest, it's total sarcastic. It was like a four sentence thing. And
nice.
I knew my manager was giggling, but like I figured the other two managers, one of them, English is not her first language. So I figured she wouldn't get the sarcasm. So I would look nice, and I'd get my little dig in. Mm. So if you can, like, kind of have fun with it while also, like, getting your point across, that's my recommendation. Because then you get laughs out of it, and, you still keep your sanity.
Yeah.
I don't know if you can do that kind of stuff.
Well, here's the thing is that that's already been done.
Uh-huh.
Because I'm just like you, man. We kind of have that vindictive kind of humorous nature about us. So I've done that. And so his reply is always, stern, like, okay, yeah, that wasn't funny. You're a douchebag. I'm like, okay, well, thank you. We deserve it. Go fuck yourself. Mm-hmm. And so today I actually drafted an email where I kind of did that, where he sent me this huge paragraph with these things. And I'm like, listen, look down below and read my response. And next to each comment or question, I'd write, thank you, and I got it, and you bet, and just things like that. Just like cynical things, like responses. And it was all drafted, and I'm like, I'm going to hit the send button, and at the last minute, I ended up pussying out. Well, I ended up editing the amount of you got it and you bet, and of course, dude. And I just put in I was like, hell's yes, that's the objection of the team. I mean, that's the team objective. And then the other one was no doubt. Mm-hmm. Or something like that. It would just, you can totally tell that it was sarcastic, and if he doesn't pick it up, then he's a fucking bigger homo than he already is.
Right. But if he doesn't pick it up, then you could have more and more fun with it.
But then his manager, who's also does not getting involved, who's also may not get the joke.
Right. Yeah. Then you know, you get your own laugh, and you don't get in trouble. I got wrong. Thank you. Yeah, it works out for everyone. That's my recommendation. I don't know if...
it's just tough.
Yeah, I don't know how much of that you can get. You know, like at some point, if he's not getting it, then it's not as much fun. Or if somebody's not getting it. Like you need somebody in the loop to be like, I can't believe he's being the sarcastic and he's getting away with it.
And I feel all the fucking stiffs that I'm working with and within the 2cc and him, and they're just not going to get in this game. I actually ended up drafting another email, and I ended up, you know, I was so furious, and I'm like, you know what, dude, I'm gonna send this email out, and it's completely like sarcastic, but at the same time with a serious undertone. I'm like, fuck it, you know what? I'm gonna play my cards. But at the end of the day, this job sucks. It's my in between job. But at the end of the day, I need a paycheck.
Unless anybody from there is listening, then it's his favorite job and he wants to retire there.
Well, it's whatever. And so I ended up actually like shooting an email to my coworker, who's my counterpart. Cool dude, and you know, he actually ended up printing the email and coming back and saying, he was like, you know, dude, if you send this out the way it is, you are going to probably have a stern talking to. And I'm like, you know what? I don't care.
Mm-hmm.
Don't care.
You know, that's when jobs get interesting, when you just don't care.
Just don't care, man. It's like, you know what? I've been working professionally for 10 years. I know how to fucking run a marketing campaign, because you think that you know more than everybody else because you are a quote-unquote lawyer, but apparently not a good one because you work in publishing and not even being a lawyer. You're a fucking sales guy. Go fuck yourself.
Right.
So such animosity, and I even do it in person, and I'm in the middle of wanting to make a request to get him removed from my team.
Mm-hmm. You could do that.
Oh, but I just don't know. I've only been there for several months. I don't know how much weight I hold.
Dude, you've been traveling the globe for this place. Every time I call you, you're in a different state or country.
That's been pretty fantastic, actually. But I still gotta get the fuck out of there. So. Whatever. I'm actually gonna be going to Costa Rica and Puerto Rico next month.
See,
if I stay.
What the fuck? Yeah, but I've hung out with you like twice in the last 3 months because you're in a different time zone all the time.
That's fun. But at the end of the day, life's only so long and it's short, and you shouldn't spend. If you can avoid spending it around people who just bring negative energy and vibe into your life, to go about it that way. Like, I just don't need this guy around.
Right.
We obviously don't see eye to eye.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I was just looking for opinions on how to deal with a difficult person.
Do you like your department?
It's awesome.
Okay.
I love my team.
Okay, so it's not like you would switch departments and problem solve. Okay.
No. It's
just this one guy.
He's on a different team. But my team works very closely with his team.
I see. Okay.
You know, like I've been assigned his accounts. Mm-hmm. You know, there's two marketing managers, me and my colleague, and I've been assigned corporate government, and my colleague was assigned academic. And so it's I've been assigned this particular.
And there's no way to switch with the other guy.
What I'm saying is, that was when I was talking to my boss, I was been proposing this. You know, why don't I do a little switcheroo with my colleague? Have him take this guy on, and I'll take another one.
Yeah.
But you know, that's completely in different departments, and I don't know if it's gonna work. So I'm gonna have to make a man. I'm gonna have to do with the situation. I'm just thinking of ways of.
Getting him fired.
Getting fucking rid of this guy. and nobody fucking likes him. I've even spoken to people in his own department. He just makes everything difficult. And so it was good to hear that he's not just making my life difficult. He's making everybody's life around them difficult.
I feel like every single person that I know has a douchebag in the department that nobody likes, sucks at their job. Nobody knows why they're there. And yet they're there and they make more money than other people. And... you know, it just doesn't make sense.
It doesn't.
And, like, sometimes even the managers know, and they're like, yeah, that guy's an idiot. It's like, well...
Oh, my boss totally knows, because my boss and him don't even get along.
Mm-hmm.
That speaks volumes.
Yeah.
And he does make more money, because he gets fucking commission. You know, so he's getting commission checks. I don't get commission checks every month.
Right, and the shit you're doing is probably adding money to his pocket.
Too. I'm the one helping him renew his clients and secure new sales with my marketing.
But what if you just did a shitty marketing job for a little while... and all his clients left, and he got fired.
That'd Great, but then what if I got fired too? Unemployment. Yeah. Actually, I don't even care for the job, so, you know.
Right. Well, if you don't care that much, it might be worth a try.
Yeah, it could be. I mean, the only thing I like about this job is that I do get to travel.
Right.
Other than that, it's whatever.
Traveling is nice.
Yeah, the traveling's very nice, and my team's awesome, and, you know, publishing is a good industry to be in. But whatever.
I'm a freelance blogger / DJ / film producer.
Maybe you should try that.
Dude, I should totally follow your lead, douchebag hipster.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I'm sorry, hipster douchebag.
I mean, it's multitasking. You don't have to spend too much time on each one.
Yeah, true. True.
Bobs.
Yeah, I agree with you there, buddy. Agree with you. But
is this organic?
What are you eating?
Well, only if it's a soy venti latte.
We don't do soy on the show.
No, not soy. No soy.
I don't agree with this new trend of calling things burgers when they're not meat.
What do you mean?
Boca burger, veggie burger. It should be called a patty. If it doesn't bleed, it's not a burger. It's a patty.
Should be called a patty.
Yeah.
Isn't it already called a patty, though?
No.
The item itself is a patty.
Yeah, but if you look on the package, it says veggie burger, polka burger.
What's a polka burger? Oh, that's just a brand.
I don't even know what it is.
I think it is a brand of a veggie burger.
Last barbecue I had, somebody brought over polka burger. I'm like, you fucking kidding me?
So that means it's a veggie burger. That's just a cool way of saying veggie.
Ugh. That's even worse than
that. Ask Hipster Douchebag. He would fucking know. Right, dude?
Does that mean it's... does polka burger mean veggie burger?
Toads.
Told you.
Okay. Well...
told you.
I still think it's really lame.
That's totally lame. Like what else is a... What if it's... As long as it's meat packaged into a patty form, it's a burger, no?
Yeah, that's the point. It's got to be meat. It's got to bleed.
So a fish, if it's a bunch
salmon
of fish.
Burger. I've had a salmon burger and it was good. Does that count as a burger? It's not bleeding, but it's meat.
But it's fitting your definition of something that would bleed.
I know. I just feel like it should be a mammal.
Like, you're saying like it should be bleeding onto your bread.
Well, at least onto the grill while you're cooking it. Or it's somewhere. There should be blood somewhere. Did fish bleed? I punched a fish in the face once, and I didn't see any blood.
I'm pretty sure they bleed. My uncle once ended up sucking the eye out of a fish and eating it, and I think I saw it bleed.
Is your uncle okay?
Well, yeah, that's pretty. It's, you know, it's called the awful food, the OFFAL, which is pretty much eating everything of the animal, like every single part, the organs and everything.
That sounds wretched.
People like that shit. For some reason, I don't even know why.
I would not do
like
that.
Anthony Bourdain needs that shit. And the fat ball guy on the Travel Channel needs that shit.
Would you do that, hipster douchebag?
Obvs.
Yeah, I figured. You know, totally don't waste anything, right? Make a freaking hemp bracelet out of
Dude. The only thing I eat, man, is white meat. And that even sounded kind of perverted.
You only eat white meat?
Well, I only eat like from chicken or if it's from beef. Or beef, I eat stuff with zero fat. I'm just a very picky eater that way.
Okay.
Even though I did eat a chicken heart the other day.
Really?
That was pretty interesting. Have you ever gone to a Brazilian steakhouse?
No, I had plans to, but then...
Dude, because that is a fucking experience all on its own.
Hmm.
So when I see a Brazilian steakhouse, what do you usually think of? Like, what comes to mind?
Definitely a lot of meat. Lot of courses, a lot of heavy, dense courses, maybe some gravy stuff, some potatoes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Not far off. They have, a buffet, you know, for starters. And so the buffet is what includes the pasta salads, the sushi, the potatoes, the rice, the veggies, it's just kind of the sides courses, like the
right.
Sides, like the apps and the sides.
I like buffets.
Buffets.
It depends though. Like buffets could either be the greatest thing or the worst thing. Cause there's nothing worse than like 20 trays of food that suck shit.
Or that people have been sneezing into or breathing on.
Yeah. Or where all the meat's like really dry. Yeah. There's nothing worse than dried out meat. It's just, but if a buffet is really good, It's one of the happier moments in life. Yeah.
Yeah, and so this place has a pretty killer buffet. You know, everything from cream spinach to sushi to salad to all ground potatoes, and so whatever. Make a long story short, once you're done with that, they actually proceed to actually come up to your fucking dinner table, and they actually give you a coaster.
That's water.
He's not pissing. Water in the form of Captain Morgan. So they give you a coaster. One side's green and one side's red. And so if you have it done with the green, it means they keep coming around and just keep giving you meat. And so they pretty much have every single cut of the animal you could possibly think of. Every single cut of meat from a cow. Every single cut of meat from a pig. Every single cut of meat from a lamb. Chicken. And they just keep coming around, dude, and putting fucking food on your plate. Food after food after food.
Sounds like a good day.
Where it comes to a point where you're like, I'm red for
right now. Is this organic?
Yeah, definitely not organic. Well, I don't know, maybe. But and so one of the things that was coming by was chicken hearts.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, you know, the guy came to my table. And they have the meat stuck into it. It's like a sword
mm-hmm.
type thing, right? And then they
skewer.
Yeah, it's like a big overgrown, oversized on steroid skewer.
Oh, nice.
Like right? And so they put it in front of you, and then they have the huge, gigantic knife on their other hand, and they say, would you like... Actually, they already know because you have your either green or red coaster on.
Right.
And so they just start slicing and, you know, whatever. And, you know, they come to the chicken hearts, and the guy next to me, my buddy, is like, yeah, why not? And then I'm like, dude, when the fuck else am I going to get a chance to eat a chicken heart?
Yeah, absolutely.
And so I tried it. I pretty much almost puked, and I swallowed it, and chucked it up as, we'll never do that again.
I had a liver, and it was really bad, bad.
Dude, liver is disgusting.
Yeah.
It has that distinct flavor.
Yeah, not a good flavor.
Have you ever eaten tripe?
I don't think so.
Ugh.
I went to a party where they had a whole pig, and it was filled with paella.
Oh,
and
nice!
All the juices cooked into it, and I want to do that for one of my next parties. It's like $400, so I got to wait for another paycheck, but I think I will have a pig party. Before the year is over.
Well, why don't you fucking have all of us pitch in and we'll fucking do it?
You know, I was suggesting that, and my girlfriend said it's cheesy to ask people to chip in
not
for a party.
Not at all.
And I said if you're having a whole entire pig, I don't think it's cheesy.
That's smart party planning.
Yeah.
Because, you know, doing the whole pig roast, very popular in Latin parties. You know,
so fucking good.
So, like, growing up, I would always see those. It's called a lechon.
Mm-hmm.
A lechon is just like a pork with filled and whatever.
Yeah.
Dude, if you have one of these things, let's make it a podcast night and, you know, charge everybody $25 at the door.
Mm-hmm.
Fucking all you can eat.
That sounds good. You know, I think I'm going to do it.
And you can draw a crowd of like 25 people, dude. Fucking make your money back and more.
Right. Yeah, no, I think I'm going to do that. Pig party.
Pig party 09.
Mm-hmm.
Totes.
Stay tuned for pictures. That's right, hipster douchebag. You'll be there. You'll be there.
Have you read the new Eggers?
I don't even know what Eggers is.
What is that?
Shut the fuck up.
Eggers?
I don't know. Some Nicole Eggers? She was pretty hot.
Oh, from Who's the Boss?
Was she on there? Who's the Boss?
No. She was on Charles in Charge.
That's Alyssa Milano.
Charles in Charge.
Alyssa Milano's still smoking hot.
Is she really?
Yeah, she was in a new movie.
Isn't she
half Asian?
No, I don't think she's
half
Asian.
No,
I don't think at all.
Okay. Anyways, what was she on?
I forget. It was a new movie that begins with a P. Not very good. She was in it for like 2 minutes. I got it because I'm like, Alyssa Milano's in a new movie, and you know, it wasn't good.
No.
I'm looking it up right now.
So oh, dude, you know what movie I just got on my Netflix that I'm gonna be able to watch this weekend?
What?
Air Guitar Nation?
I just started taking guitar lessons this week.
Stop it.
Pathology is the movie. Don't get it. It was awful.
I think I'll follow your lead on that. No, but that documentary, Air Guitar Nation, what's it called?
Air Guitar Nation.
Yeah, dude.
Is that about the like contests?
The fucking worldwide contest
for
fucking air guitaring? I'm fucking stoked.
If anybody has Xbox, get the new update. You can now watch everything on the Xbox. All the watch nows that were only available to the computers, now watch through the Xbox.
Excited. Can I watch nows on Macs yet?
Yeah. You could do it on Macs. You could do it on PCs. You could do it through the Xbox. It's all good. Oh, okay,
good, because I wasn't able to do that before.
Yeah, and I'm getting my girlfriend caught up on Dexter, which is what I think is one of the best shows right now. Are you caught up on that?
Actually, 8/18 is when they released season 3.
Okay.
So on 8/18, in a week or so, I'll be getting the new season, or the last season. Mm-hmm. So I'm a season behind everybody else.
Me too. I watched the first episode. I may have obtained the whole season.
But then I
got my girlfriend hooked on it, so we're like two-thirds of the way through the first season. So I'm just going to get her caught up.
Cool. It's a great show. You know what I actually got into, man? True Blood, which I was here with you once.
Yeah.
And it was a very slow start, and Marissa really liked it. And so I was like, these first episodes kind of suck. It didn't really go anywhere.
Yeah.
But I can kind of see the second season being good.
Don't like the show at all. Girlfriend loves it, so I'm forced to watch every episode. So we're one episode behind, 3 days behind. Pretty much caught up.
Yeah, I haven't seen the new season yet.
What is there, 6, 7 episodes from the second season?
Yeah, same as Entourage, so 6.
So we watched, all of them except one. Still don't really like it, but stuck watching them all.
You watch Entourage?
Yeah, I do. Same thing. Well, just didn't watch this last week's.
Yeah, so I'm all caught up. And, Jay's actually a pretty bad influence when it comes to watching stuff that's not on HBO. That's on HBO, not on HBO.
What are you talking about? Nothing. Everything is totally legit.
So I'm actually all caught up, and they actually had a Patriot on there. Your favorite person, Tom Brady.
Nice. Well, by favorite, you mean not favorite?
Yeah. That's a good show. It's I would like things for them to sometimes end not on such a happy note. It's like, ooh.
Well, they had a whole season like
happy.
That. They had an entire season like that last season.
Yeah, but things
were... No, they were like, he was broke and he was losing his shit. And like, people were actually not liking the show because it wasn't happy. Because
he wasn't winning.
Yeah. And I'm like, if they were happy for 6 straight seasons, you'd be so sick of the fucking show. Like, yeah, you got to have some sort of, because the first 3 seasons, it was nothing but good shit happening.
Yeah.
Like, they needed to have some, but people didn't like it. They started to stop watching. So now everything's back to good and I'm bored as hell. Like, I also feel like nothing happens in that show now. Like, one tiny thing happens, and that's an entire episode.
Well, I mean, they're trying to build... this is what happens with E. I like what's happening with Lloyd. He's stepping it up, that little fucking dude.
Anything interesting in the whole show right now is happening around Ari. Artie's coworker, Lloyd.
Because...
everyone else has nothing going on.
Let's think about it, dude. Ari is the best character on that show.
He is. Well, I don't know.
Hands down.
I was a huge Johnny Drama fan until this season. He's got nothing this season.
The drama's all right. I like drama.
Nothing's going on this season.
Well, drama? No, not really.
I could give a shit about E. Ever. Yeah,
he's doing his thing. I like what's happening with Lord and what's happening with Ari.
That's it.
And
that's it. There's nothing else going on. It's stupid.
Well, whatever. It's still a good. It's still a good show. I watch it on Fridays when I work, quote unquote, from home.
It's still watchable, and it's still like, I guess, better than a lot of shows on TV. But it's definitely not as good as it used to be.
Yeah. Actually, I noticed there was a show on TV the other day that it's about fat people dating. Have you happened to see the show?
Oh no, I saw the commercials for that though.
Yeah. Apparently, the networks think that we want to see fat people hooking up.
No, the new show is Dating in the Dark. That's the new show.
Dating. Oh, is that with fat people too?
No.
It
may be with ugly people. there's 6 people, 3 guys, 3 girls. I'll go over it real quick because we went over this in another episode. They go on. They're in a big room and it's pitch black and they talk. And then
they're fat.
No, they're not fat. Well, some of them might be. And then they pick who they want to go out with. And then they go on a one-on-one date with that person. It's also still pitch black. And then after the one-on-one date. They're still in a black room. They'll shine the light on one person, and you can see in the night vision goggles the reaction of the other person, and then they do vice versa.
Mm. And they're fat.
And then the guy waits on the balcony, which is right above the front door, and the girl either goes through the balcony and goes on a date with him for real in the light, or she thinks he was gross, and she leaves through the front door, and he gets to watch her leave. And that's the premise of the show.
So what you're saying is it's pretty much a sociological test to see if looks do matter.
And they do, because all 3 girls picked one guy last time and all 3 of them walked through the front door.
Mm. So. I think my show about fat people sounds more exciting.
I like my show, my midget program.
Wait, is there a midget dating show? I'll totally fucking watch that. If dude, let's pitch that to a fucking network.
If there is, it'll be on TLC.
That's fucking...
I pitched five shows for TLC last episode.
You did?
Yeah.
Oh, did I didn't get a chance to listen to that.
Small people, tall, everything.
What does that mean?
It's just like they're in a house where everything's on really high shelves, and they have to figure out how to cope with it. Or how to get
around it.
Yeah. Little people, dangerous house, where there's just like traps and dangerous things.
you gotta somehow include a midget toss into the equation, or midget bowling.
Mm-hmm.
My buddy once had a bachelor party, and my buddy's brother once had a bachelor party where they had midget bowling, where the midget was actually like rolled up into a ball, like just think about like this.
Right.
And was actually like rolled like a gymnast, like into other midgets.
I mean, that sounds
cruel and evil, but it was fucking hilarious.
I mean, it's amusing, but the midget has more control than you do over it. He can get a strike if he's in a good mood.
But what about midget darts? Where you ball them up and you throw them up against a big, huge thing of darts.
You got to be pretty strong. Midgets are still like 80 pounds. If you're throwing an 80-pound guy with accuracy, you're pretty fucking strong.
Well, I don't think accuracy was the objective of the game.
How far can you throw 80 pounds? I don't know.
Not me. I'd be probably about two people.
I mean, if that was like...
What are some good games to play with midgets?
That game where you throw the bean bags into those holes. I forget the name of that. Yeah. You can do that.
But you're saying that you can't pick them up and throw them.
Well, that you'd need two people, hands and feet. Right. And then you throw them into little pits. You could do that.
Throw them into little pits.
Or... on ice, you could probably do curling.
Fuck yeah, that's a good idea.
Midget curling, you could definitely do that. There's not too many midget sports you can do.
Well, let's think about it and revisit this.
Yeah, midget sports next episode.
Yes. What do you think, hipster douchebag?
Obs.
Yeah, right. next week, obs.
Cool.
So I got a couple of news stories. I don't know if you want to go over those.
How long have we been on?
We've been on almost an hour, so we can stop or we can do news stories. Mm-hmm. We've been on an hour. Crazy.
Craziness.
Totes.
Totes, dude, for sure. All right, let's go ahead and cover one, and then I gotta skedaddle back into the city.
All right. There's actually another one. Did you hear Bloomberg has been shipping out homeless people?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Get them out of here.
Did you hear? That's a real program, though.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
He buys them a one-way ticket, and
one-way ticket to paradise, baby.
Yeah.
I actually, that story is interesting and amusing and all. I actually like what you currently have on your computer, though. And here's the thing: he currently has a story on the computer apparently it aired on the Phoenix Fox Network. And it's about a woman arrested in KFC for condiments dispute. Now, this is why this kind of caught my attention, because I've actually gotten over disputes over condiments myself.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a self-proclaimed condiment king.
Okay.
I feel that condiments belong on absolutely everything you eat. You know, the old motto, eat safe, wear condiments.
Now, are you a package condiment or do you get bottles?
Everything. I'm ideally bottles, but if I'm a store, if I'm eating out, let's put it this way, I was in an airport 3 days ago coming back from Toronto, mm-hmm. and I went into a place that had a hand that offered packaged mayonnaise and mustard, mm-hmm. and because I take my lunch to work, and I usually don't like to eat my sandwiches without mayonnaise or mustard or whatever, and I was totally out. I grabbed a handful, I put it in my pocket.
Mm-hmm.
I was wearing a suit, so I picked up a handful of.
Don't tell me it broke and you look like a pervert.
This is so embarrassing. No. The thing is that I actually grabbed a bunch of mayonnaise, a bunch of mustard in Toronto, put it in my suit pocket, brought it back to Manhattan, and today took it to my office and ate, spread it on my sandwich. That's nice. How fanatic I am with condiments.
Do you know what the rarest condiment in a package is?
Hot sauce?
Sweet relish.
I get that all the time. Heinz does that.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, I just made up that rarest fact.
Yeah, you're totally full of shit.
Yeah?
Maybe horseradish.
What about tartar sauce?
Dude, tartar sauce is... Have you ever gone to an Arthur Treacher's or
a White Castle?
A Long John Silver?
All right. I'm going to go with sweet relish. I don't see that anywhere.
It's everywhere. If you go to Nathan's, they have sweet relish in a bag.
Oh, yeah?
Absolutely. Absolutely. So anyway, so I'm a huge condiment fan.
You are, because you just totally called me out on my fake tidbit.
Absolutely, dude. I love
that. I thought I was going to make up a random tidbit.
I love that shit.
Totally shot me down.
I'm even considering about making my own salsa and dip, and my own salsa and hot sauce, and selling it at a farmer's market.
Sweet baby Leon's.
Absolutely, baby. So anyway, so tell me about the story. I want to know what happened because wait. And before we actually get there, I was once at this fucking KFC. No, Popeyes. Fucking hate Popeyes. They don't give you what you want.
As far as what? I don't like the commercials where the lady is saying, you want two pieces of my chicken? It's not your fucking chicken. Who are you? You weren't even born when Popeye started, you idiot.
Oh, my chicken, $2? You must be crazy.
My chicken. Dude, so they don't allow substitutions. And they're very stingy on their condiments.
Why wouldn't you allow substitutions?
So listen, all I wanted is I think the offers are like, you know, you can have a side of Cajun rice and a side of yada, yada, yada. Well, what I wanted was a fucking corn on the cob. I'm like, listen, you can take any other side that I'm supposed to be ordering right now, and I want you to give me the corn on the cob instead.
That's not that unreasonable. It's not like you said, can you take out the coleslaw and add another piece of chicken?
Exactly.
Corn on the cob is fairly cheap.
Exactly.
Very cheap,
and
actually.
It should be a side. KFC offers it as a side. Why the fuck don't you, Popeyes?
Idiot assholes.
So I got pretty upset with them.
Yeah.
They then proceeded to not only deny me my corn on the cob without having to pay extra, they denied giving me a second tub of ranch dressing for my chicken.
Why?
Completely denied.
Did they want to charge you more, or they just ignored you?
I've been to places where I've been charged for condiments in the first place. You know, like McDonald's and like, you know, somewhere I'd be like, oh, you know, it's quarter. Quarter for what? Whatever. And so they actually wanted to charge me for more at this particular, on 14th Street, Popeyes. Make a long story short, I got into a big argument with them. It's a picture of this.
Rightfully so.
Arguing about the fact that I wanted corn on the cob and they weren't willing to give it to me. And B, they wouldn't give me a second tub of ranch dressing. Made a bit of a stink, I'm not going to lie. Walked out.
Okay.
And so I am very curious as to why this woman was arrested at a KFC over a condiments dispute. Go.
Well, she wanted honey mustard. And she didn't get it from the KFC.
Been there, sister.
Well, instead of walking out and being all rational like you did, she tried to run over a KFC employee.
Stop!
Yeah, she was going...
Wait, can we read this?
Yeah.
Verbatim? Go ahead.
Yeah, sure. Witty first... Everyone has to have a witty first line. Blame it on the honey mustard. Yuck, yuck. Police say it all started when a disgruntled customer didn't get the condiments in her KFC order. Police arrested a 26-year-old woman when they say tried to run over a KFC employee, all because the employee failed to provide condiments with her meal.
Holy shit.
Well, we've all been there, and we can deal with her. You know, we can relate with her frustration.
Wow.
You're not talking, are you? Good. Surprise, police say that Monique...
Surprise is the name of the town.
Yeah, it shouldn't be surprised.
No. Surprise is the name of the city in Arizona where she's from.
Wow. Okay. Glad you're paying attention. The police from there were saying that Monet was going through a KFC drive-thru near some road Wednesday night, and the argument began. It escalated, and she went inside the store. She was ordered to leave the building. KFC employee followed her out of the building and stood behind the vehicle to get her license plate number. Well, they're an asshole. Why would you fucking do that?
Why would you not give her fucking damn honey mustard?
Oh, I'm going to report you to the cops because you wanted something we didn't give you.
So Argue began to pull out of the out, and the employee struck the trunk to let her know that she was in there in case she hadn't seen her.
How about take a step to the side instead of punching her car?
Police suspect that Aguet, the woman who was just being charged, continued to back out again despite the employee's warning. The employee was struck but not hurt. Aguet was arrested on suspicion of aggravated assault with a deadly weapon and disorderly conduct. This again, people, all over a little tub of honey mustard.
You know what? As much as I like to laugh at these people and, you know, say how stupid they are. I think I'm actually on her side.
I am 100% completely on her side, dude.
Not only did they follow to her car, they hit her car.
Instigated shit.
Yeah.
And really, a little fucking bag or a little tub of honey mustard, what cost the company, what, 5 cents to produce?
At most.
Give me a break.
At most. Probably less.
Probably fucking less. And they wouldn't give it to her?
Nah. She should have run the entire establishment over.
And you guys will see her picture. It's hilarious.
Yeah. She's like, well, she's kind of still want that honey mustard.
Yeah. For sure. So anyways, that's a woman arrested in KFC condiments dispute on the Phoenix Fox TV channel.
Put that in the live chat room for our listener.
I like that.
Yeah. Yeah, unbelievable.
Good story. Where'd you find? How'd you find this?
I have my sources.
All right. Well, all right, man. So I think I gotta get going, man. But thank you for having me on the show, man. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, thanks for coming on. It was good.
I gotta do another one soon.
Absolutely, man. We'll plan this power hour thing. It's gonna be done soon.
Childless man released from child support debt.
Hey, listen, don't tease everyone if you don't want to do the stories.
Well, your headlines are eye-catching.
Well, I go through all this trouble finding all these awesome stories.
All right, this caught my attention, too. Talk to me.
All right, childless man released from child support. This guy has the worst life I've ever heard, ever. This guy doesn't have a kid, spent 13 months in jail. See, for anybody who says that, you know, I'm against minorities, the first lady was Spanish, this guy's black, and I'm on both of their sides. So, suck it. All right. This guy spent 13 months in jail for being a deadbeat dad, even though he had no kid.
Stop it, dude.
Not only that, he was paying child support for 13 years.
No shit.
13 years.
What are the details?
I can't imagine how much money that is. He had a girlfriend who had a kid who apparently was a whore because it wasn't his kid, and also a liar asshole. So he finally got a paternity test. Found out that it says he learned that child might not be his, so he took a DNA test. And that confirmed that the child wasn't his.
So he paid child support for 13 years and spent 13 months in jail.
Yep. He paid...
You gotta be kidding me.
He was ordered to pay over $16,000, and after $10,000, he found out that the kid wasn't his, and so he stopped paying, and they didn't believe him when they said it wasn't his, even though he had the paperwork. Threw him in jail for 13 months, and then they said, oops, you're not in jail anymore. My bad. Sorry about those 13 months.
Fucking Georgia.
Can you imagine having your life taken away?
And for 13 years paying fucking child support for a child that isn't even yours?
That's probably a big chunk of his salary.
That's getting a shocker a couple times right there.
Yeah, that's fucked.
The shocker. You know what the shocker is, right, Jay?
Two in the pink, one in the stink.
There you go. Wow, dude, that's fucked up, man. This poor guy, John Daughtry. Not Johnny Daughtry. That's a sheriff. What was it? Was this guy's fucking, this poor sucker's name?
Frank Hatley,
50 years old, spent 13 months in jail for being a deadbeat dad before his release last month. A judge ordered him jailed in June of 2008 for failing to support his quote-unquote son, a child who DNA tests proved not to be fathered by Hatley.
That judge should be in jail for as long as he put the guy in jail.
Right, dude? I'm totally fucking agreeing with that.
Because the guy brought in the papers and they didn't believe him.
That's fucked up.
Fucked up.
Poor fucking dude.
That sucks.
Yeah, it sucks to be you.
How bitter would you be if you were in jail for a year for no reason?
Oh my God. And had to pay 13 years of child support.
Just complete unbelievable. What is this? This is just a picture gallery of crazy shit that this guy ran into on the subway.
Sportspickle.com?
No. Yeah.
Is that funny shit?
So, that poor fucking guy. Anyway, I think that's about it for this week's show. Thank you for coming on.
Hey, man. Awesome being on. Whoa.
Please continue to vote on Podcast Alley. Poor month for voting, but, you know, we can still get there. Next month, I expect everyone to vote on the first day of the month, get us into the top 10, because... Seriously, our numbers took a huge hit this month, and that is not good. Yeah. I spent all this time putting together a good show, getting guest hosts, and, you know.
Hey, people, that's unacceptable.
It takes, like, literally 30 seconds?
Yeah, unacceptable. Come on, let's keep it up.
So, you know, send us your votes. And soon I'm going to ask people to put comments on iTunes. I guess if you want to do that now, that's cool, too. I want to get featured on iTunes, but I figure if I can't even get people to vote, they're not going to put a comment.
I think we should make some kind of incentive for people to vote. I mean, because, you know, sometimes listeners just, you know, didn't really have the time to do that and go out of their way. So maybe we should run some kind of contest where, you know,
I'll give you a dollar if you vote.
Or if they vote several times, or if they make a case to make other people listen and vote and can prove it, they'll get a night out with you and the crew. Some quirky and fun like that.
Right. Well, not everyone's from New York, and I don't think they want to fly in for that.
That can be a grand prize down the line.
Right. I could send them a shirt.
A shirt? There you go. Some collateral. Some marketing stuff. I'm speaking like I'm still at work. Leon, please turn off. T-shirts and fun stuff is what I meant.
How about everyone who votes gets a dollar? I can do that.
Your wallet, not mine.
If I get over 75 votes, everyone who votes gets a dollar. Next month, September 1st.
And tell your friends, will you? And let Jay know how much you despise me being on the show, and that'll probably encourage me to come on more often.
You got to put a comment on your vote so I know that you actually voted. So that's it. I guess we'll be back next Wednesday with Peter, the return of Peter.
Oh, Peter. Is Randy also going to be on the show?
No, she'll probably sit in the background. She was our designated giggler last time, which I like to.
Can I come on the show next week?
You want to?
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
My schedule is completely free next week, and I think three days in, I may get really bored.
Peter and Leon next week.
Lock it in.
And then sometime soon after that, there'll be the Power Hour show. And, you know, maybe another new guest host coming up. I'm trying to tighten the rotation, though. So go on the forums, post who you like. You could start a new thread, or you can just post under. I have a section for every single person who's been on the show. You can post under there. I like this guy. I don't like this guy. I'm going to tighten up the rotation and try and get a regular rotating crew for show consistency. So,
like the objective.
Yeah, yeah. So give me your feedback, who you want to hear more of, and we'll, you know, we're going to try and tighten up the rotation. Maybe Leon. Maybe you like Leon. Tighten up the rotation in September.
Hope not.
So, hope not. See, that's what everyone says. Please don't vote for me.
No, vote for me. And just, you know, the less they like me, the more I want to be on.
All right. Perfect.
Just kidding.
So, yeah, do
love
that.
You people.
And we'll be back next week. Thanks for listening. And we'll be back next week. Follow us on Twitter, twitter.com/brinkofsanity. I always post a message the day before telling what time and day the live show is going
to
air.
Would it be cheap for me to plug my own Twitter page?
Not at all.
Bolivar_79, which is BOLIVAR_79. You can follow me, find out what shenanigans I'm up to, and that's how you do it.
You know, you got some good posts or twits or whatever you want to call it. A lot of people are really, really boring with it.
Yeah.
But you actually put some redeeming stuff on there, which is good.
Well, thanks for having me, man. I had a good time tonight.
Yeah, thanks for coming on. Cheers. So we'll be back next Wednesday. Talk to you later. Bye.